how to continually nourish your mind. Nourish the mind as you would your body. The mind can't survive on junk food. Imagine Eve back in the garden. She's sitting there talking to the snake and she's a little confused. The father of lies is creating doubt. He is contradicted what the father said to her, and yet she reaches for the apple. Now imagine what would have happened if she had pulled back her hand and said, "Okay, you stay right there, I'll be right back." What she had called out, "Daddy, Abba, Heavenly Father," and sat down with him to have a chat about what the snake had said. "You see that little snake over there? Here's what he told me, what is truth and what is a lie. If she had done that, do you think the story would have looked differently?" If we were going to recognize the lure of temptation and avoid the three hooks of sin, we have to know the truth so that the truth can set us free. This takes place through a dynamic relationship with Jesus by His Spirit living in us and knowing the truth. Paul said it this way: "For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds." We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. What does that mean? It means that we grab a subscription thought and we say, you are coming with me. We take it a captive and we present it in front of Jesus and we say, "Jesus, I just had this thought. Is this a lie or is this your truth?" And we pray, "Lord Jesus, open my eyes to your truth." By His Spirit, He will start to reveal His truth to us as we also compare the thought to what we know from the written truth of God in the Bible. Today, when a thought enters your mind, and as soon as you recognize that it might be a lie, take it captive to Jesus and say, "Jesus, what do you think about this?" And then test it with what the Bible says is truth. Consider a thought you are wrestling with right now. Take it to Jesus now. Jesus, you are the very, the truth, and the life. You know all things, and your word is the test of all things. Search this task I am bringing to you, and lead me in your eternal way. I trust in your presence within me and your word to live out the truth today. Amen. How to identify fact from fiction? A lie that is accepted as truth will affect your life as if it is true, even though it is a lie. Sometimes our strengths can be our biggest weakness. Often our weaknesses can be our biggest. Well, weakness, unless through Christ we allow Him to be strong through us. Both strengths and weaknesses make us vulnerable to the lies of Satan. Perfectionism may value is in my performance. Arrogance, I deserve better than this. Tendership, I am more important than the people behind me. Anorexia, I am fat. Materialism, if I have a little more, I will be satisfied, fulfilled, and happy. Material discontent, I deserve a fling. giftedness. I can't do it myself. Slyness, no one will ever know. Consciousness, I must be guilty. What are your strengths? What are your truth? God has revealed his truth to us in scripture, in the Bible. It's the original, the authentic, the genuine article. Everything else is counterfeit. And the very best way to recognize the counterfeit stuff is by knowing the real stuff. When my dad was young, he was a bank examiner in England, and one of his responsibilities was to find counterfeit money. He had a whole week of training to figure out what counterfeit money was like. They had him study every detail of every bit of normal real bills, and he said, "This is ridiculous. When do I get to look at the counterfeit stuff?" And they said, "Oh, you are not going to look at counterfeit stuff. That stuff changes all the time." When you know the truth, the lies are obvious. When you know the truth, the Satan whispers a lie through the power of sin toward your strengths or weaknesses. You will recognize it for what it is. Then you can choose to allow the Spirit in you to respond in truth. Holy Spirit, show me today where my strengths or weaknesses have made me vulnerable to a lie. Give me a lifelong hunger for your word that you might implant its truth in my mind. Then grant me the willingness to obey it. Amen. God is your place of refuge. You will find rest in me. Road trips are exciting adventures. There is so much to look forward to. The scenery, long playlist of your worried music, and deep conversation with your companions. That's less adventure. Some are the road signs that promise. Great food, but just as you try to change lanes and veer right, a semi-truck shows up out of nowhere. And just like that, you miss your exit. Whatever rest and enjoyment the sign promised is now a blur in your rear view mirror. That can happen in your spiritual life too. You can seek the promise of rest you read about in God's word, but then completely miss out on experiencing his rest. I am your place of refuge. Road trips are exciting, adventurous. There's so much to look forward to the scenery, long playlist of your favorite music, and deep conversations with your companions. What's less adventure? Some are the road signs that promise great food, but just as you try to change lanes and veer right, a semi-truck shows up out of nowhere. And just like that, you miss your exit. Whatever rest and enjoyment the sign promised is now a blur in your rear view mirror. That can happen in your spiritual life too. You can seek the promise of rest you read about in God's word, but then completely miss out on experiencing his rest. Hebrews 4 part 1 reads that none of you be found to have fallen short of. This rest God promises is in the present tense. This verse of scripture isn't referring to your final rest or rest in heaven. It's talking about today, the here and now. So long as you remember the therefore that explains God's promise of rest. The author wants you to keep in mind the history of Israel. the first generation of Israelites refused to enter their promises place of rest. More accurately, they refused to trust God that this was indeed the place He had prepared for them. As a result, they stayed in the wilderness, wandering, wanting and whining, and their unbelief excluded them from experiencing God's rest. But that's not all. The second generation of Israeli did enter the promised land. When God said, go, they went. This second generation entered God's promised place of rest, but they too failed to experience it. Why? It was another round of unbelief on their part, which shows us that even inside the place of rest, they struggle to trust God. That's what the author of the book of Hebrews is saying to you today. The promise of rest still stands, but not miss it. Believe God's invitation to rest is for you today, and then trust His promise, asking the Holy Spirit to strengthen you with a wavering faith. And remember, it's either God's rest or not rest at all. Making sure you're ready for what's to come. In the face of all terror and uncertainty and illusion about the future, we gladly point to Jesus and say that He is the future. In March of 1942, Pearl Harbor was still in ruin and Japanese forces were tightening their grip on the Philippines. General Douglas MacArthur was following orders by President Roosevelt to leave the islands to relocate. But it felt like a step in the wrong direction of the seasoned soldier, perhaps trying to convince himself of the necessity of the move. He would later write, "We are not retreating, we are advancing in another direction." At the end of that month, he uttered the now famous word, "I came through and I shall return." Nearly 2,000 years before that day, another man had made a similar promise. He was living for good reason, and his promise to come again was even more certain. That man was Jesus Christ. Approximately 300 passages in scripture allude to Christ's second coming, a return that will be swift, righteous, and unexpected for many. Jesus gave His word that He would be back, and through that promise we can find tangible hope and clear direction for our lives today. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. Life can slip away on us quickly as days turn to weeks and weeks to years, and years turn into decades. It's easy to lose focus on the promise of John 14. Being distracted from this future event, however, can rob us of precious perspective for today. MacArthur made good on his promise, returning to the Philippines as the Allies pushed back through the Pacific. Jesus will return too. He is the ultimate promise keeper. When? But I am not sure, but we are at least 24 hours closer to that event than we were yesterday at this time. So Don't let your heart be troubled. Trust in God. Jesus, open the implication of your word to me now. Tell me the truth. In the days ahead, I want to ponder the meaning of your return and prepare accordingly. Counsel me by your spirit so I might live each remaining day with wisdom and purpose, living today in light of tomorrow. The future just isn't what it used to be. The Bible alludes to the return of Christ at least 200 times, trying to pin an exact date on his return is very difficult. Still, this seems to be an ongoing hobby among Christians. Throughout the centuries, hundreds of predictions have been made, and they all have one thing in common so far: all were wrong. My favorite example was a little book entitled 88 Reasons Why Christ Will Return in 1988. By carefully manipulating numerous prophetic versions, the Bible, the author concluded that Jesus would come back in September of 1988. The author sold about a zillion of these little booklets where my dad was a pastor. We were constantly getting calls from people trying to get copies from the church's bookstore. As September drew near, the callers kept asking my dad why he wasn't carrying the book. "Call me back in October," he said. Nobody called. In Matthew 24, Jesus told the disciples about many of the signs that would be seen before he came again. Honestly, it looked like a lot of them are taking place around us here and now. We may have entered the season of the last days of the last days, but putting a date on his return, Jesus made one thing very clear. No one knows about that day or hour, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage up to the day Noah entered the ark, and they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. That is how it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. My concern is that false and foolish predictions have the same effect as the boy who cried wolf when the town's people became numbed to the false warnings and were therefore unprepared when the event actually did take place. Instead of fruitless predicting, Jesus called us to be and make the most of the time we have left for things that matter. Lord Jesus, calm my mind, stir up your spirit inside of mine, and let me truly ponder the implications of your second coming. Check my priorities, Lord. Expose what I am living for today. Shift my trust to you and empower me to live by your spirit today. Amen. Where to find strength in these last days? We are living in the age of the church. It is an age of grace and an age of the Spirit, in which we have, by God's mercy, claimed to the world the good news about Jesus Christ. Let's be honest, aren't we all just a little bit skeptical about Christ's return? It's been almost 2,000 years and none of us regularly check the skies to see if his return flight is coming in. Peter's words to the believers of his day are just as relevant today as they were then. They are sober words that put it all in perspective. Above all, you must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. They will say, "Where is this coming promise?" Ever since our fathers died, everything goes on as it has since the beginning of creation. But they deliberately forget that long ago, by God's word, the heavens came into being and the earth was formed out of water and by water. By these waters also the world of that time was deluged and destroyed. By the same word, this present heavens and earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of ungodly. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. Noah had given plenty of warning, but everybody just kept on doing their own thing. Then came a wall of water. Whoosh! Today it's the same thing. Jesus has given plenty of warning, but many who don't know him go about their way indifferent or unaware. He will intervene again in judgment. Plenty of believers are doing the same thing. It is so important to constantly remind ourselves that we are in a very precarious season of human history. We live between the game winning play, the cross and resurrection, and the end of the game, his second coming. God is taking his time to give us time to play the game through to the end with everything we have. Lord, I want to use these remaining days, be they few or many, to make an eternal difference. Give me your heart for those who are perishing. Then live through me in a way that communicates to them your tangible love. Amen. Living above the circumstances, what matters most? Jesus reached out to all sorts of people, from the most despised to the highly respected. He wasn't concerned about what people thought of his actions, and he wasn't concerned about fitting in with the crowd. Jesus cared about embracing people, teaching them truth, and changing their lives. The Bible reminds us how Jesus always put love and compassion above all else, and how he wants to work through us to help us follow his example and impact people's lives. Find rest in God's promises. Are you searching for reassurance and the promise of better times in a world that simply doesn't offer it? When the world tells you there is no reason for hope, we want to remind you that despite current circumstances, Jesus has come to give you abundant life, and you have his word on that. This month, we are focusing on God's promises of an abundant life of peace and hope. especially at such a time as this, and be reassured in the hope that only Jesus can offer. How to make the most of each day. Build me a son, O Lord, who will be strong enough to know when he is weak, and brave enough to face himself when he is afraid. One that will be proud and unbending in defeat, and humble and gentle in victory. Scouser was my sport as a kid. I grew up in England, so Scouser was normal. But there is one thing that isn't normal about the Scouser. The scoreboard doesn't have a clock. The referee is the one who keeps the time. And when it comes to the future, the father is the one who keeps the time. From cover to cover, the Bible contains hundreds of passages that deal with the second coming of Christ. Some of these verses are in apocalyptic literature, including books like Daniel and Revelation. These books are beautifully written and fascinating to read, full of wild imagery, an amazing snapshot of future history, but they are very difficult to interpret. Few of the passages are presented in a clear sequence, so determining the order of the events that take place around the second coming of Christ is a real challenge. If you want to be a serious student of this stuff, you will first have to learn a whole new set of words like premillennialism, postmillennialism, and amillennialism. Once you're through with the new set of isms, you will need to figure out if you are pre-mid or post-tribulation. I have to admit, I have always liked a good debate, but my concern is that we get so caught up in dating and debating that we forget the point. Imagine you are watching a World Cup Scouser match. It starts getting pretty intense, but all of a sudden the guys from one team sit down in the middle of the field and start debating about when the game is going to end. Sure, we could spend a lot of time and energy debating it and trying to convince our own teammates to see our point of view. But what's the point? Paul put it to the Ephesians this way: wake up, O sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Be very careful then how you live, as not as unwise but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Jesus, come soon, my Lord, come soon. But between now and then, I ask that you will live through me, that I will think as you think and see as you see. Amen. Where are your blind spots? You can fool yourself, you know. You think it's impossible, but it turns out it's the easiest thing of all. A couple years ago, I wrote a book based on the Apostles' Creed entitled Bleed Matters. I like to double meaning in that title. It dealt with theological matters of belief, but it continually reminded me that what we believe matters tremendously. A dear friend, Dave, learned this the hard way. During a season when his marriage was drifting, a lovely young woman came into his office. He met her needs and she fulfilled his desires. Willingly he was drawn into her seductions. Consciously he ignored the heartfelt warnings of his friends at church. Intentionally he decided to leave his wife and two small kids for this younger woman. The pastor of the church engaged him. Looking across the table at him at a dinner, his words were clear and few. "We've got to talk about church disciple, Dave. Until you have walking with Christ again, you are not welcome to worship and fellowship with us. We look forward to seeing you come back." It was a slap in the face, but the shocking truth woke him up. With no one else to blame, he felt the shame and realized the consequences of everything he had lost. He went home to his wife and begged her to forgive him. By God's grace and in his power, she did. In time, they restored their marriage and have been together ever since. It's a stunning story, but what stunned Dave was how easily and truly he was deceived by the evil one. He told me, "I actually got to a place where I, though it was God's will for me to leave my wife for that other woman, I believed it was what he wanted for me." He was a living example of 2 Corinthians chapter 11, part 3. "But I am afraid that just as Eve was deceived by the serpent's cunning, your minds may somehow be led astray from your sincere and pure devotion to Christ. Is it possible that you, a believer in Jesus Christ, could be deceived by the father of lies too? Father, humble me, show me my blind spots, reveal where I think I can stand on my own, show me where I am already in sin, where I am already taking control of my life in my own limited strength and flawed wisdom. I surrender to your loving leadership and your eternal wisdom again. I trust you in me to do what is right. Amen."